Hi there, Marius here with the Resuscitation Coach. On this channel, we do all things resuscitation, so please consider subscribing. In today's video, we'll be discussing the Pediatric Advanced Life Support, or PALS, systematic approach based on the 2020 American Heart Association guidelines. So let's jump straight in. Here we go. We should always use a systematic approach when caring for a seriously ill or injured child so that we can quickly recognize signs of respiratory distress, respiratory failure, and shock, and immediately provide life-saving interventions. The American Heart Association's PALS systematic approach includes four components: the initial assessment, the primary assessment, the secondary assessment, and diagnostic tests. We'll be looking at the individual assessments as to make your PALS systematic approach easier. Throughout our PALS systematic approach, we will follow the evaluate, identify, and intervene sequence as we take care of the sick or injured child. From the information gathered during our evaluation, we'll identify the child's clinical condition by type and severity and intervene with appropriate actions. So we'll constantly evaluate, identify, and intervene. Remember, team, at any point, if you identify a life-threatening condition, immediately intervene with your life-saving interventions. We use the Pediatric Assessment Triangle, or PAT, to make our initial assessment during our first quick from the doorway observation of the child. Appearance, breathing, and color within a few seconds after encountering the child. Here we focus on what we can see and hear before touching the child to help identify the general type of respiratory, circulatory, or neurological issues that will require urgent treatment. The initial assessment helps us to quickly identify life-threatening conditions. If at any time we identify a life-threatening condition, immediately we will need to start intervening and activate our emergency response system. If a child appears to be unresponsive, immediately follow your BLS assessment of activating the emergency response system and then checking for the breathing and pulse. If the child is not breathing but having a pulse, we will start with rescue breathing by giving one breath every 2 to 3 seconds, which is 20 to 30 breaths per minute. If the child does not have a pulse, immediately start with high quality chest compressions by pushing hard and fast in the center of the chest at the rate of 100 to 120 pushes per minute, remembering to allowing the chest to fully recoil. Do not interrupt CPR for longer than 10 seconds and do not hyperventilate. You want to give just enough air to see visible chest rise. How deep do we push on the chest? You want to push down 1/3 of the anterior posterior chest. If we do not detect a life-threatening emergency, we can continue forming our initial impression of the child's condition using the PAT. So, appearance. Here we're looking at the child's appearance, including the level of consciousness and the child's ability to interact. Breathing. Here we'll focus on the work of breathing, the position, and any audible breath sounds that we can hear. Keep in mind, this is without your stethoscope. So we're looking at things like stridor, grunting, and wheezes. Here we also look at signs of absent or increased respiratory effort. Under the circulation or color, here we look at the child's overall circulatory status. Assess the child's color, including the skin, and for obvious signs of bleeding. This section will provide us valuable information about how well the child is perfusing. Look for pallor or paleness, mottling, which irregular skin color on the face, arms and legs, or cyanosis on the lips and fingernails, a sign of inadequate oxygenation. Flushing can be a sign of distributive shock, or petechiae, or purpura, which is bleeding under the skin, which can point us to a possible sepsis. The primary assessment uses a quick hands-on ABCD assessment, and you'll assess the child. Airway, breathing, circulation, disability, exposure. As you proceed through each component of the primary assessment, treat life-threatening abnormalities in real time before you complete the remainder of the assessment. Under the airway, ensure that the airway is opened, maintained, and protected. Review the breathing rate. Is it normal, fast, slow? Look at the breathing pattern. Review oxygen saturation, and if the saturation is below 94%, start oxygen. Check the respiratory effort and listen to the lungs and airway sounds. A critical concept here is that when there is a consistent respiratory rate less than 10 or more than 60 in a child of any age, it's often abnormal and warrants further assessment for the presence of potentially serious conditions. A tip here is to evaluate the respiratory rate prior to the hands-on assessment, as anxiety and agitation will increase the breathing rate. Also, bradypnea or an irregular respiratory rate in an acutely ill child is an ominous clinical sign and often signals impending arrest. Under C, we need to evaluate the heart rate and rhythm, blood pressure, capillary refill, which should be below 2 seconds. Also the central and peripheral pulses. Weak central pulses are worrisome and might indicate the need for rapid intervention to prevent cardiac arrest. So what is the definition of hypertension by systolic blood pressure and age? So for a term neonate, between 0 to 28 days, it's 60 millimeters mercury or below. For infants from 1 to 12 months, it's 70 millimeters mercury and below. For children between 1 to 10, it's age times 2 plus 70. And children at 10 years of age and above, it's 90 millimeters mercury. The blood pressure are based on the fifth percentile. The fifth percentile is a systolic blood pressure that is lower than all but 5% of normal children. Under D, perform a disability assessment to quickly evaluate neurological function using one of several tools to evaluate responsiveness and level of consciousness. Perform the evaluation towards the end of the primary assessment and repeat it during the secondary assessment to monitor for changes in the child's neurological status. Tools that we use includes AFPU, which stands for alert, voice, pain, and unresponsive, and our Glasgow Coma Scale or GCS. There is also a modified GCS for pre-verbal or non-verbal children. Also check the pupil response to light. We use the acronym PEARL, which stands for pupils equal round reactive to light. And last, but definitely not the least, consider the blood glucose. Blood glucose, 50 milligrams per deciliter or 2.2 millimole per liter or less in the newborn, and 60 milligrams per deciliter or 3.2 millimole per liter and below in children gets classified as hypoglycemia. So we need to decide if our case is a respiratory case, a shock case, or a combination of both. If it's a respiratory case, we need to decide if it's respiratory distress or respiratory failure. And from there, it can be classified into one or more of the following types: upper airway obstruction, lower airway obstruction, lung tissue disease, and disordered control of breathing. Examples of upper airway obstruction could be a foreign body aspiration, anaphylaxis, and croup. Examples of lower airway obstruction can be asthma or bronchiolitis. Lung tissue disease involves parenchyma or tissue of the lungs. Examples of disordered control of breathing includes disorders like seizures, central nervous system infection, head injuries, to name a few. For more information on respiratory disorders and treatments, please refer to Part 7 and 8 in your PALS manual. Shock is defined as a physiological state characterized by inadequate tissue perfusion to meet metabolic demand and tissue oxygenation. It is often, but not always, characterized by inadequate peripheral and end organ perfusion. A critical concept is that shock does not require the presence of hypotension. Shock can be present with a normal increase or decrease systolic blood pressure. Compensated shock refers to a clinical state where signs of shock is present, but the blood pressure is in the normal range for age. Hypotensive shock or decompensated shock is characterized by evidence of impaired perfusion. The types of shock is hypovolemic, caused by reduced intravascular volume due to things like diarrhea, vomiting, and bleeding. Distributive shock refers to a clinical state characterized by reduced SVR leading to maldistribution of blood volume and blood flow. Examples could be septic shock, anaphylactic shock, and neurogenic shock. Obstructive shock refers to a condition that physically impairs blood flow by limiting venous return to the heart or limit the pumping of blood from the heart, resulting in decreased cardiac output. Causes include pericardial tamponade, tension pneumothorax, massive pulmonary embolism, and ductal-dependent heart defects. Cardiogenic shock refers to reduced cardiac output secondary to abnormal cardiac function or pump failure, resulting in decreased systolic function and cardiac output. Common causes of cardiogenic shock include congenital heart disease, myocarditis, arrhythmias, and cardiomyopathy. So let's start with our secondary assessment. The sample mnemonic provides us a memory aid to help us recall the important medical information necessary to provide you the best care for your young patient following a systematic approach. S stands for signs and symptoms, A for allergies, M for medications, P for past medical history, L for last meal, and E for events leading up to the injury or illness. Next, we need to perform a focus physical examination. We need to repeat the vital signs, check for changes from the previous vital signs taken during the primary assessment. Check the vital signs is an ongoing evaluation. For our head-to-toe evaluation, we will start at the head, ears, eyes, nose, and throat. Chest, we will look at the heart and lungs and the outer chest. We'll be looking at the abdomen. We'll be looking at the extremities, the back. And don't forget to repeat your neurological function test. Diagnostic assessments includes further assessments like your chest x-ray, ECG, ABG, your echocardiogram, to mention a few. If you benefited from this video, kindly like, subscribe, and smash that notification bell. We'll see you in the next video. Have a fantastic day.